Hi. It's so nice to see some really familiar faces and new faces. Thank you for your interest in my great-grandfather's art and the Chasing Portraits story. I know some of you have heard me speak before, and for those of you who have, I ask you to bear with me briefly while those who have not heard me speak before get caught up on the story. And then I promise a new story that I have not told before that does appear in my book, but only in an end note. So it'll be fun to share it here tonight. Hello. What happened? There it is. Sorry. It's good to get the technical difficulties out of the way early. My story begins with a man I never knew, Moshe Rynecki, a prolific Warsaw-based artist who painted the Polish-Jewish community in the interwar years. He perished in the Majdanek concentration camp in the Holocaust more than 70 years before I was born in San Francisco. He was my great-grandfather, and this is his self-portrait. What is Chasing Portraits? Chasing Portraits is a multi-layered, multimedia project. There's a book, a website, and a documentary film. But the center of the project always has been and always will be my great-grandfather's art. But to understand my story and my quest, I need to first introduce you to my family. This is my family in the 1970s. That's me on my mom's lap. And then there's my father and his parents in the photograph. My father and his parents are Holocaust survivors, and for those of you who keep track of all these different terms, that means I am the daughter of a Holocaust survivor, as well as the granddaughter of a Holocaust survivor, or also 2G and 3G, which is a little unusual to have both and to be have both those connections. I'm obviously not a Holocaust survivor. I cannot bear witness. I am, however, uniquely situated to tell you this story. I share this photo not because I particularly like it, because I kind of think I look dorky, but but because it shows something very important. You can see on the wall behind me a painting, and that's the painting that I've also imposed above me in the photograph here. I grew up with my great-grandfather's art prominently displayed on the walls of my parents' and grandparents' homes. It's always been there. I don't remember it ever not being there. But like most things that we grow up with, we often take it all for granted and fail to really see and ask questions that we probably should when we have the opportunity to do so. The hidden blessing of having nobody tell me a whole lot about the art was that I didn't have predispositions about what I should and shouldn't be seeing it. I got to understand the art on my own terms. Some days I saw the art and looked at it carefully, and other days it just was there and I walked by it and didn't pay a whole lot of attention to it. But on the days that I did look at it, I could see things and over time got to understand the paintings that I saw very well. I saw gestures and I saw color and figures and light. I'm not a curator. I don't have a degree in art history, but what I do have are years and years of exposure to a body of work my great-grandfather produced and an intimate familiarity with his style and composition. The person who really knew my great-grandfather's art was my Grandpa George, and my Grandpa George grew up not only surrounded by the art, but by watching his father actually paint the art. The obvious person to teach me about my great-grandfather's art was my grandfather, George. But sadly, that didn't happen when I was a kid. I was too busy trying to figure out my own way in the world, and I probably wasn't a whole lot interested in family history or genealogy, and maybe I didn't even know what questions I really should ask. In 1992, the year after I graduated from college, I was living in Washington, D.C., and my Grandpa George died here in California up in Humboldt County in the far northern reaches of the state. I came home from the East Coast for the funeral, and after the funeral, my parents and I went to pack up my grandfather's house. And while we were there, my dad went to put something in the trunk of his father's car. And when he did so, he came back in the house with a pile of papers. And he said, "I found something I think you'll be interested in." And what I want to do now is read a little bit from my book about that moment. Flipping through the pages, not actually stopping to read any of it, I saw words that caught my attention. Jews, Warsaw, anti-Semitism, hiding, Germans, Majdanek, and Hitler. I looked up at Dad. "Oh my God," I said, "it is a memoir. He wrote about the war years." I felt an intense desire to read every single page at once, which made it almost impossible to focus. I sat down thinking it would help me concentrate, but I kept flipping pages. I couldn't stop to actually read an entire page. A number of years before, when I was 16, Grandpa had shown me some of his writing. He had wanted my opinion about whether or not it was any good. His use of English was confusing and sloppy. He had commingled stories so that a tale about Poland in 1480 was intersected with a memory of the Second World War. I hadn't understood the thread of his story. I couldn't make out his goal in storytelling. I don't exactly think I was mean in my critique, but I didn't offer praise or insist he keep writing. I know I'm not talented like James Michener, and who am I to even compare myself to a writer of such magnitude, Grandpa had said. I never spent a single day in an English-speaking school, but I have stories to tell, and I must, because I am a survivor, and if I do not write them, who will? I recalled this exchange as I looked at his journal and realized he had continued writing despite my lack of enthusiasm. Grandpa had felt the importance of his story and of passing on this written history to his granddaughter. He had been wise in ways I didn't comprehend. He had written so that when he was gone, I would know. How do I know this? Because as I turned the pages, unable to read any one in its entirety, I spotted a paragraph, one that had my name in it. Grandpa wrote, "Some say it will never happen again. Well, it's too easy. It did happen. They killed openly without fear. Where and how did they have that much hatred toward us? It could happen again. We cannot and will not forget. We will carry it like the Bible forever. There are hundreds of books on the subject. Nevertheless, I am a Jew and I write. I'll do it till the end of my days, if only for my granddaughter Elizabeth to know the truth and to not be afraid of it." Time stopped for a moment. The nostalgia and sadness I felt weighed upon me. If history and legacy make a sound as they fall upon your shoulders, the clamor of Grandpa's words landing on mine was deafening. For a long while, I was torn, unsure of how to even begin to bear the responsibility I felt, and only fitfully engaged with my family history. Over time, I realized how deeply I yearned to learn more, and I began to pursue the lost fragments of my family's history, a journey that eventually came to be called Chasing Portraits. This book is that story. But the story doesn't start with me. It begins around 1890 with my great-grandfather Moshe in the Polish town of Siedlce. We believe that my great-grandfather was born in 1881. We know that he was born in a very small town east of Warsaw and grew up in the slightly larger town of Siedlce. He was the 13th of 18 children. That's a lot of kids. Life was difficult, and only 5 children survived assorted illnesses, 3 boys and 2 girls. Moshe had a traditional Jewish education. He also attended a Russian middle school. I know for a fact that he attended the Warsaw Academy of Art for at least 1 year. I'm not sure if he was there for other years as well. I am many things. I am passionate, persistent, and curious. But one thing I am not, as I noted before, is an art historian. So my interpretations and commentary about my great-grandfather's art may not be that of a docent or a curator, but I speak from a place of family and identity. And in this painting, what I see is powerful. I see a man, my great-grandfather, conflicted. A man who grew up in the Polish Jewish community and knew that world well, but left that world to live an assimilated life, but continued to paint the Polish Jewish community because he found it rewarding and meaningful. I see all of that in this painting. The fact that he's painting himself in Western garb, the fact that he's painting the Jewish wedding, but that he's slightly removed himself from it. He's looking at us as if to actually acknowledge us, but to separate himself a little bit from the scene that he's painting. Moshe wasn't supposed to be an artist. His father was never very enthusiastic about his painting. I know that both from my Grandpa George as well as from other materials that I've actually been able to find. For a couple of reasons. One, probably because he wasn't very excited about the prospects of what kind of living he would make at being an artist and how much money he could earn. But the second, of course, was the concern about making graven images. So his father decided that the best way to end the whole conversation about art was to marry him off. And if he married him off, then he would have a wife for whom he would be responsible for, and they would have children, and he would have to get a job and a real career and make real money, and that would be the end of the art career. Fortunately, Moshe had a couple of things going for him. The first is that he believed in himself and he continued to paint. The second thing is that the woman he married, Perla, the woman in this painting, seemed to not to object to his painting. And so Perla managed a store that Moshe's father actually bought them, which was at 24 Krucha Street, which was in a non-Jewish part of Warsaw. It sold art supplies, and Perla took care of the store while Moshe went out in the world and painted. This painting was done in 1929. Moshe and Perla had two children, first a daughter, Bronisława, at Wright, and then a son, my grandpa, Jerzy, which was later Americanized to George. Bronisława in this picture is about 7, so my grandpa George is about 5. Moshe was a prolific artist in the 1920s and 30s, or as some say, the interwar years or interwar period. He had a style that's really uniquely his own. And although he often painted similar scenes like these four, which really show men in religious study, they really are also very different in their composition, in the way he showed the men, in the way that the background portrayed the scene. He also painted everyday workers. What I love about these paintings that he did is there seems to be a balance between showing the machinery that they worked on and their skill and the individual themselves, although the individual is never really entirely identified. I don't know if he didn't really like to paint faces or he just preferred to have them sort of be slightly anonymous, but this was pretty typical of these types of paintings that he did. That's not to say he didn't do portraits. He did do some, and my family has some of these pieces, like this girl. Unfortunately, I have no idea who she is. Moshe didn't paint the rich and famous. He painted the everyday workers, the people he knew well. This is a scene photographed by Roman Vishnak in 1937 in Lublin, a water carrier. And I show it because it looks so much to me like this painting, which is, if you have the book, you know, is on the front cover. Interestingly, the Vishnak photograph was taken in 1937. My great-grandfather painted this scene in 1930. Or like these girls. This was taken in 1935 in Slovakia, again by Roman Vishniak. Here's my great-grandfather painting such a very similar scene in 1928. Did Vishniak and my great-grandfather know one another? The honest answer is that I haven't a clue. It's possible. It seems unlikely. But what to me is so much more interesting and reassuring and reaffirming to me is that for so long I thought what my great-grandfather was painting were scenes he was imagining or dreaming up or fantasizing about. But in fact, it seems to me that these were everyday scenes. He and Vishniak saw the same thing and in their own poetic ways chose to record and document those moments. I often get asked if my great-grandfather was well-known or famous. When I started this project, I have to admit, I just kind of thought he was a hobby painter, that something that he did on the weekend. I didn't really understand that it was his full passion. And when I discovered these newspapers, I realized that perhaps he wasn't really famous, but he was known. The papers that you're seeing here, this doesn't have a pointer on it. The one closest to me with the blue trim on it is a Polish paper and shows a painting that we believe is partly a self-portrait. And we have no idea if this painting survived the war, and if so, where it is. The paper in the middle is a German paper that is sharing news of an exhibit that featured many of my great-grandfather's paintings. The painting that is circled in green, we know, is at the Jewish Historical Institute in Warsaw. The other three pieces, if they survived the war, again, I don't know where they are. The two bottom newspapers are Yiddish papers, and the one in the top right corner, Naz Prezglad, which I'm sure I know there are a couple people here tonight that actually speak Polish, and my apologies for my non-existent Polish accent. But that paper is a paper that was a Warsaw Daily, and they often did an art insert. And on the cover of this particular insert is a painting that my great-grandfather did that is titled Hanukkah. On September 1st, 1939, the Nazis invaded Poland. My dad was not quite three. This is a picture of my father and my grandpa George, slightly before the war in Gdynia, which is up on the Baltic Sea. This is a ditch digging effort that took place in the early days of the war by Polish citizens to try to stop the advance of the German invasion. My grandpa George actually took part in an effort of a ditch digging effort like this one to try to help out. My great grandfather continued to paint. And in my mind, those two images look awfully similar. Whether they actually are, I can't tell you. I can only just tell you my hunch for that. In the early days of the Second World War, my great grandfather became concerned about his body of work. He had, we believe, around 800 paintings and some sculptures in the early days of the war, and he became concerned about how to protect them. And so he made a decision to divide his body of work into bundles, to take the pieces that were in canvases out and to roll them up into packages and to give them to friends and acquaintances in and around the city of Warsaw, with the hope that whenever he didn't know it was going to be 6 years of war, was over, he would return to collect the pieces and his collection would be whole once again. He created somewhere between 6 and 8 bundles. He hid the bundles. He gave lists of where he hid the bundles to his wife and his two children, and then hoped for the best. Unfortunately, on April 1st, 1940, the Nazis began the construction of the Warsaw Ghetto and ordered all the Jews in Warsaw and its suburbs rounded up. There were something like 400,000 people inside the closed walls. The ghetto had a 10-foot-high wall topped with barbed wire that was closely guarded and prohibited movement. It was about 1.3 square miles, which, I don't know, I'm not a very math-oriented person, and I'm not very good with size and packing things, and I like to see something that relates to my own life. So this might be slightly disturbing, but I took the city of San Francisco, and I used a program, because everything's on the internet these days, and I made a grid of 1.3 miles. Going from Presidio Heights to almost the Panhandle and between about Divisadero and Fillmore, San Francisco had a population in 2013 of about a little over 800,000 people, so half the population of San Francisco squeezed into that small space. It's disturbing when you think about it that way, right? Moshe willingly went into the Warsaw Ghetto. My father and his parents stayed out on fake papers. My grandpa George begged his father not to go into the ghetto, and he tried to get him out. Perla eventually agreed to get out on false papers. Moshe's ending is, of course, tragic. He perished, we believe, at Majdanek. My father and his parents spent the war years in Warsaw. They mostly were on the Aryan side, and like I said, they had false papers. In 1944, Grandpa George was arrested in Krakow. He was eventually sent to a prison in Czechoslovakia. The Germans thought he was a spy. Eventually, he was put on a forced march towards Dachau and was liberated by the US Army near Bad Aibling. And a quick aside, this painting actually was gifted by my family to Yad Vashem a number of years ago. And earlier this year, an exhibit of 100 paintings from Yad Vashem was loaned to the German Historical Museum in Berlin. I'm told that close to 50,000 people saw the exhibit, and this painting was one of those 100 paintings on exhibit. After the war, Grandpa George, my grandmother, and dad were at the Bad Aibling DP camp in Germany for a while before moving to Italy. This is a paper that my Grandpa George was issued to be part of this thing called the Polish Committee. He was helping the Allied forces deal with Polish refugees in the DP camp. This red and white armband at the right was issued to him by the Allies. And then this picture in the lower corner is my father and his parents in Rome after the war. Around the same time that my father and his parents moved to Italy, Allied troops moved across Europe, liberating people and discovering the massive extent of Nazi looting. Some of these images might be familiar to you. The Jeu de Paume in Paris, which is where the art that they looted was taken, and people like Goering went to pick out the paintings that they wanted for their own collection. In the bottom picture, if you saw The Woman in Gold, this image was used in the movie. It was recreated. It's a warehouse that was used to hold objects that were taken in the Mobile Action or the M Action. Literally, they stole everything from apartments, of Jews that were forcefully deported or had run. So they took dining room sets, they took chairs, they took dinner plates, they took toys, they took anything, and then they loaded it all up onto trains and shipped it back into Germany for Germans to have. And then the image at the right is in the Merker salt mine. That picture shows 8,000 bars of gold, as well as bullion and bales of foreign currency. And then, of course, the sad image at the bottom of, I believe it's a rabbi looking through these Torah scrolls. This image shows what Moshe's wife Perla encountered when she tried to recover the art in Warsaw. Warsaw was massively devastated for four reasons. The first was the initial invasion in September 1939. The second, the ghetto uprising in April 1943. The third, the Warsaw uprising in August 1944 by the Polish underground to liberate Warsaw from the Nazis. And the fourth was the Russian occupation of the city after the war. It was into this that my great-grandmother Perla and a cousin went to search for the hidden bundles of my great-grandfather's paintings. They found just a single package, just over 100 paintings, in the basement of a home in the Praga district across the Wisła River in Warsaw. According to Grandpa George's memoir, there were over 800 paintings and sculptures before the war. This shows only 80, but only because I couldn't squeeze 800 on one single frame. But I show it to you because the percentage of paintings that my great-grandmother found out of the 800 was this, about 15%. They assumed everything else had been destroyed. That was the bad news. The good news, they were wrong. When I first took my tentative steps into this project, I set out to find paintings that I thought were ours. Restituting art, really, at its basic level, is so super easy. If it's not yours, you give it back. And many art experts and nations agreed. In fact, in 1988, representatives from over 44 countries met to discuss developing a consensus of non-binding principles that would assist in resolving issues related to Nazi-era confiscated art. Eventually, 44 nations signed those Washington principles. Many of those nations met again in 2009 to rediscuss the Washington principles and recommit to efforts on these matters, and they signed what became known as the Terezin Declaration. This is not a Moshe Rynecki painting. This painting, the portrait of Adele Blockbauer I, is perhaps the most famous piece to be restituted. Often called the Lady in Gold or the Austrian Mona Lisa, her story is familiar to many. If you read The Lady in Gold or you saw the movie Woman in Gold, of course you know the story well. The long story short is after many years of legal battle, the painting was returned to Maria Altman. She then sold it to Ron Lauder for a reported $135 million. It is now on permanent display at the Neue Gallery in New York. And if you haven't been to see it and you're in New York, I highly recommend going to see it. It's beautiful. I share this story because I want to tell you that my story is nothing at all like this story. My great-grandfather's paintings aren't this famous, and they weren't hanging in world-renowned museums, and they're just not this valuable. But we do have our own stories, and I use the plural on purpose because each painting is a different case, a different set of circumstances, and a different tale. I hope some of you are here tonight because you saw this fun and quirky story in San Francisco Magazine. For those of you that didn't, they gave it this great title. They said, a detective story, sort of. And they said, they kind of made it a recipe. They said you needed to have a family secret, get lucky, and make friends. And I know they were kind of joking and sort of teasing me, but it's actually pretty true. I mean, the more I think about it, the more on target, really, they were. And so now I want to sort of take you on one of these detective stories and show you how these pieces and puzzle come together to make the chasing. I mean, that's the chasing part, the adventure to discover the lost and missing pieces. Some of you have heard parts of this story before, but I promise it will be a little bit different. In 2004, we were contacted by a man in New York who said he had six of my great-grandfather's paintings. He would only show us these two photographs. He wanted to sell them to us. We didn't buy the paintings, but what I want to tell you is what ended up happening as a result of that. So when we decided that we would consider buying them, we turned to an art appraiser and said, well, how do we know what they're worth? How do we provide an offer that would make sense? And they said, well, did any sell at auction? And we said, no, of course not. We've never sold anything. And they said, well, that's interesting because Sotheby's Arcade in New York in 1993 sold two paintings for a combined hammer price of $1,700. And I said, well, what do those two paintings look like? Because I didn't know anything about them. I called Sotheby's in New York, and they were really nice to me, but they said, we don't have photographs of the paintings. Sotheby's Arcade is a lower-tier auction house, and there were no photographs in the catalog, and so we can't show you any photographs. And so who am I to argue with Sotheby's? And so I said, okay. But then something interesting happened. In 2015, here's where the friend part comes in. In 2015, I got an email from a Polish friend doing research in Israel. And she said, do you know this piece? And I said, no. Where did you get this piece? And what is this? And tell me more. So 22 years after it was sold at auction, I finally had a photograph. But what was really interesting about this catalog was that this wasn't the New York catalog. This was an October 1993 sale in Tel Aviv. But it only had the one painting, and in New York they sold two paintings. And even stranger was this provenance in the catalog. At the bottom it said, after the German retreat, 150 works of Rynecki were discovered in the basement of a Warsaw apartment block, including the present work. Now, provenance is the story that, and I shouldn't just say story, it's the history of where art has been, who's had it, how they obtained it. And it's really important because if you have clouded provenance, then your ownership is a little bit under question. So this was intriguing because we weren't selling this piece. I had never even seen this piece before. So if there were 150 works discovered in a basement, that meant somebody else had another 150 pieces that I didn't know about. That was option one. Option two was that somehow Sotheby's didn't quite have correct information. And the truth was, I just didn't know which it was, but there was a big question mark. And given that Sotheby's and Tel Aviv suddenly had a photograph of the painting, I circled back and wondered if, in fact, the people in New York actually had a photograph of the other painting. And so I called Sotheby's in Tel Aviv, and I said, can you tell me more? And they said, sure, here are the catalog pages from the New York auction. And what's interesting is that you can see, so I've sort of shown you all the pages here. One shows the description of the paintings, one shows the image circled, and then the larger image at the bottom. And here is a slightly better of just the two. Now, I remind you of the two empty frames that I showed you before, right? So those tell us nothing because I couldn't tell you what the image is. Now I have the image, only I always want more because who's satisfied with just part of the story? And the question was, who has them? And can I see the original? And what do they look like in color? Things have a strange way of working out sometimes. And so I backtrack a little bit because nothing's quite linear in the Chasing Portraits project. In 2015, I went to Poland. The man in New York who tried to sell me six had in the meantime moved back to Poland. And he, when I told him I was filming footage for my documentary film, very kindly agreed to let me come into his home. And this is a photograph of me, the back of us, looking at several of the paintings on his wall, including these two. And when I met with him, I said, his wife was there, and she said something like, well, when we sold two at auction, I said, what do you mean you sold two at auction? And she said, well, we decided that two didn't really fit in with our collection, and so we wanted to sell them. And so I said, did you sell the two at Sotheby's? And the husband said, I didn't sell them, she sold them. It was this very strange thing. And this is this long, winding story, but it's worth telling because to me it just seems fun and whimsical. So we left that interview. I showed her the black and white paintings. She said, yeah, those were the two, but she remembered them in color, so seeing them in black and white wasn't very good. We went to a movie that night about Jan Karski, which my cinema photographer was actually the producer and director for, and they came to the movie. And at the movie theater, they, unbeknownst to me, handed my my friend who was there filming with me a package. And she handed this tube, and with strict instructions that I was not to open the tube until Slavik was filming. This is Slavik. So here you are. These are action shots. This is like behind the scenes action. So this is Slavik filming me opening the tube and my having zero idea of what was in the tube. What was in the tube? Remember the black and whites? Color. There's nothing quite like seeing them in color. It'd be better if I even saw them in person. I don't know where these paintings are. I have some clues, but I have been unable to get further than that. So if these paintings, and I'm going to say this and you're going to think this sounds funny, but if these paintings look familiar and you know the person that has them, please tell them I'd like to see them. I think that part of chasing portraits is actually finding the paintings, but what is more powerful and rewarding to me is rescuing the legacy. So I'm often asked, are you trying to get the paintings back? And that's a long story that's in the book and is hard to sort of just summarize this evening. But my goal has been to rescue my great-grandfather's legacy and to share his artwork with other people. And so I have stepped aside from being a claimant, and instead I'm acting as a historian to try to do that. One of the other things that was interesting about this painting that I now had a color piece of was that it looked really familiar to me. I spend probably far too much time staring at these paintings, pictures of them. And so I went back through my database of information and I found this. So the piece that was sold at Sotheby's was done in 1934. This other piece was done in 1932. And the one at the bottom is owned by the Jewish Historical Institute in Warsaw. And again, I'm not a docent and I'm not a curator, but to me, this is fascinating. And there, you know, depending on how you look at it, there are more characters, there are less characters. The angle is ever so slightly different. I have no idea what he was thinking, but yet it feels like a window into his thinking process and feels like it starts to give us a better sense of his role as an artist. How the heck does somebody search for lost art? Sometimes it's a matter of finding clues and following up, like the story I just told you. Some clues are more elusive, and again, I'm not teasing you. This is entirely serious. This is how this project has moved forward. I'm going to share some clues with you, and if any of them ring a bell for you or you run across something later, let me know, because maybe it will help me resolve some unresolved questions. So the one that says glass plate photo, my family took photographs of paintings in Italy after the war, and this is one of the photographs that we have. So I know my family had it after the war, but nobody knows where it is. And so it could be in Italy, it could be in the United States. I don't have a color photograph of it. I'm desperately looking for it. The middle piece is kind of like when I showed you the newspaper clippings earlier. It's from a newspaper art supplement. I don't know if it survived the war. I am, of course, looking for it. This one on the far right, 1935 Brussels International Exposition, is really interesting. We know that my great-grandfather showed at the 1935 World's Fair. We don't know how many paintings he showed, and we don't have a catalog to know what exactly was shown. I would love to find more information on that. I've had some roadblocks on that. Again, if you have a best friend in Brussels that's a Jewish art curator and knows a lot, give him my number. And then the bottom piece here is from 1930. And what's really fascinating and sort of fun for me is that this was produced by the Warsaw Society for the Encouragement of Art. And this shows that my great-grandfather showed 10 paintings in this show, and it shows the titles of paintings that he showed. Some of the titles are titles that we would recognize. So the Polish in there is for Talmudist study in there. And so it could be a painting that we have, but it's so hard to know because we don't have images to go with it. And like those four paintings that I showed you together early on, it's possible that, you know, it was a similar titled painting, but a different scene. What of my great-grandfather's paintings and this journey taught me? I'm going to read you one more passage. And then I'm going to show you a film clip. And then we're going to do Q&A. All right. Chapter 23, Looking Forward. I am a writer, a reader, a lover of words on the printed page. The bookshelf in my office is filled to bursting with Holocaust-era memoirs, words put to paper to document the horrors and atrocities of the past. Each shelf has a row of books lined up neatly, but above each row are horizontal stacks of books crammed into every available inch. The shelves are bowed from the strain of holding up the books. Above the bookcase, next to a pair of windows, hangs a painting. It's this painting, Luna Park. It's probably my favorite Rynecki painting. It's not large, 19 by 13 inches, but the fairground it portrays is somehow larger than the canvas itself. A sprawling carnival with brightly colored tents and the Polish flag, a horizontal bicolor of white and red. At the center is a swing ride, a carousel where eight figures in chairs suspended from the rotating top fly across the blue sky. Below, wandering between the green, pink, and blue tents, a large crowd lingers. My great-grandfather's paintbrush rendered them a multitude so deep and full of life, it's impossible to distinguish individuals. At the right is a merry-go-round with wooden horses. So often when we think of Jews in Poland, we think of all that was lost and destroyed in the Holocaust. We focus on the devastation and destruction, and we wonder how it is possible the world went so dark and how there could be such deep, vicious, and murderous hatred. My great-grandfather's paintings have taught me that while we endeavor to understand this history, we must also remember beyond that, to a time in Poland when Jewish life flourished. I think this is why I love Luna Park so much, because I can almost hear exuberant, cheerful music floating across the fairgrounds. It is a painting of hope and joy. The juxtaposition of painting of hope and joy above a bookshelf filled with despair became especially poignant upon my return to California when my overburdened bookshelf finally collapsed under the weight of history. The jumble of hardcover books and paperbacks, a veritable chronicle of the Jewish people, lay piled on the foot of my desk. It was, I surmised, a sign of some sort. Perhaps a simple one to buy a new bookcase. But it also seemed so much more, a reminder of the physical burden of memories the next generation must bear. I simultaneously felt both guilty and angry about how a past not exactly my own weighed so heavily upon me. I craved guidance and approval from my great-grandfather as well as Grandpa George, though of course this would be impossible. I wondered if my ancestors would be pleased by my dedication to the art and the history, or if they would tell me it was time to move on with my own life. But I can't, and perhaps I never will, because there are seemingly endless unanswered questions and unresolved issues. So, as I mentioned, chasing portraits is many things. It is the art, it's the book, it's the website, and it's a documentary film. These are some stills from the filming process. And I just want to tell you a little bit about the film. The film has 501c3 sponsorship from the National Center for Jewish Film. It has grants from the Coret Foundation and the Toby Foundation here in the Bay Area, as well as the Claims Conference, as well as many individual donors and Kickstarter backers, some of which are here tonight. Thank you for all the donations that you make. The small ones and the big ones make a huge difference. The film is in post-production editing, and my editor is actually here tonight, and I am thrilled that we are working so hard on getting it done, and we're getting close. We are working towards getting a rough cut, which we hope to have in the next few months. And I have really exciting news. This weekend, I got a call from someone I know who has requested to remain known as an anonymous donor. And the anonymous donor has given me a grant challenge. They are giving me $25,000 with the hope that I can match that. They'll match me dollar for dollar up to $25,000. If anybody is interested in giving any amount, there is information at the back of the room, or you can talk to me tonight about it. The next thing I want to do is show you the 3-minute trailer and then open up for Q&A.
The paintings of your great-grandfather were coming back to Poland, and the train was bombed, and the Polish villagers, what I understood, robbed the train, and they had boxes, crates with the paintings.
Work of my great-grandfather, Moshe Rynecki, and I'm wondering if you've ever seen work by him. He was a Jewish painter in Warsaw in the interwar years. Somebody told me I should come to Kolo Bazaar and that I might see something, and so I'm curious.
Impossible.
And so, impossible.
No.
No, never. Okay.
What's very special from my point of view of Moshe Rynecki's work is that he comes from a religious family and from a very intact and very rich and deep Jewish milieu, and that served as a great source of inspiration. It's the traditional world refracted through a modern sensibility.
In fact, such a collection, presentation, and such an interest in Jewish life is unique. I think that Rynecki helped us not to recreate, but to think about the Jewish life differently.
Works come out from the abyss of being unknown through work of people, of living people. Through your work and the webpage that you have and the research that you are doing, I think this is always the mechanism.
When I learned a number of years ago that not only had other pieces survived, but that you guys had 52 of them, it was this jaw-dropping moment.
It's amazing.
He's my great-grandpa.
Okay.
Yes. You know, I think that some people, when they come looking for paintings, are here to reclaim paintings. I'm not here to reclaim the paintings.
Yes, of course.
I'm here as a historian.
It's still a possibility that we can find somewhere, you know, new pieces in Poland.
I have never seen this one. That's fantastic. I should be in the microphone. So now I'm told that there are microphones available and that if you have questions, you should raise your hand.
First question right here.
Yes. Elizabeth, can you tell us how many paintings you have located or identified either through images where you may not have found the paintings yet themselves, and also how long that's taken you.
So I've been working on this project pretty steadily for about a decade. I have the number of images that I've found in total, including physical paintings and just images, is probably, like I said earlier, I'm bad at numbers. It's close to, it's between 70 and 100, somewhere right in there. There are 52 pieces at the Jewish Historical Institute. There are 4 pieces in a private collection in Canada. There are pieces in Israel and private collections in Poland, as well as New York and France. And that's what I know about.
Question is back here.
Quick question. Can you please clarify the reason why you said your great-grandfather went to the Art Institute of Warsaw at least 1 year, and then that the provenance researcher clipping said that he graduated from the Art Institute in Warsaw?
So the only thing I've been able to find is it's kind of like a yearbook from the Warsaw Institute of Art, and it only shows the 1 year, and I just don't know. Let me answer that slightly differently. I do know that he continued to have mentors in Warsaw who were accomplished artists, and that he continued to work with them and be involved in various organizations like Zachęta and institutes that promoted Jewish artists. So whether or not he was actually a full-time student, he did continue to, at the very least, be self-taught and maybe take more classes. But whether or not he actually had a degree from the Academy of Art, I'm unclear about.
The next question is right back here.
Oops, thank you. You've talked so much about chasing the art and the portraits and the evolution of your great-grandfather's paintings. I'm wondering through this process, Elizabeth, what your relationship has been to him as a person and what you've uncovered in the process and how that perhaps has changed what you've learned about him personally, and if and how that has changed at all your connection to your family and your family's history.
Yeah, that's a really good question, and it's one I think I'm still sorting through, because I think it's complicated, and for a long time I just sort of understood that it was the art, and obviously it's an extension of who he was and how he saw the world and chose to record it. And so I do think, you know, I talked in the opening a little bit about how that self-portrait where he's looking at us, but it's the wedding scene. To me, paintings like that are so powerful because I feel like I get to understand him a little bit more. How it relates to my own sense of self, I think I would step back and just even say it's sort of a bigger picture, and that it makes me realize that personal stories, all of our personal stories, are against a larger backdrop of history, and that it makes me understand that a little bit better. And so I feel like I've come to know him better. I don't know if my Grandpa George would have agreed with my assessments and conclusions, but it sits better with me that I understand it more now than when I did when I was a kid.
The next question is in the back.
I have two questions. Number one is, were the people with 50 pieces mostly from one source, like one bundle? And number two is, where is Luna Park?
Luna Park is in the San Francisco Bay Area, the 52 paintings, that's interesting. So after the war, there was establishment of an organization that was not originally called the Jewish Historical Institute, but it was this organization that was, in the earliest days after the war, trying to collect Jewish ephemera and cultural artifacts. And they had some money. I'm not sure exactly where they got it. Some of it might have come from the joint. Some of it might have come from donations. But they took donations of pieces, and they also bought art. And the 52 pieces that the Jewish Historical Institute has from my great-grandfather come primarily from like 46 and 49, but they also have pieces that were acquired in the 60s and in the 80s. And while I don't think they're actively trying to look for more pieces and acquire them, if somebody came to their doorstep today and said they'd like to sell a piece, they would probably be happy to acquire it.
The next question is right here in the front.
Do you have any way of knowing whether he actually sold any of his paintings at the time? Did he get paid for portraits? Did he make any kind of a living from his paintings?
Yeah, that's a great question, because one of the things as a claimant that you are told is you have to prove that the art actually belonged to your family. And one of the problems I discovered in my research was that he did try to sell artwork. And I don't know exactly which pieces he sold and when, but there are paintings with price tags on them and also documentation that show prices that he that were listed for pieces that he was trying to sell. And also, of course, artists barter for art. They give their friends art. They trade art. So it's hard to know the pieces that other people have precisely how they obtained them. And some of them could be totally legitimate.
The next question is here.
Yes, I was wondering if any of your great-grandfather's artistic talent and muse was passed on to any of George's children or cousins. Are there any artists in your family that you know of?
No. I'm a hobby photographer, but no, I can't draw. My children don't. They draw stick figures.
The next question is right in the front.
I wondered if there was any insight from that family in Israel about the 150 paintings found in a basement. Did they have any information on that?
No, because I think the way, here's my guess of what happened. Two pieces sold at Sotheby's, New York. One individual bought both and decided to spin off one and decided to sell it in Sotheby's in Tel Aviv. As for getting a real answer to that question, no, I've never been able to get any more information.
The next question is back here. Is your reason for not trying to become a claimant or to actually be more involved in actually acquiring the art that perhaps you can get better to the story if it's clear that you don't actually want the pieces?
So that's really a multi-layered question, and part of that's really explored in the book, because I, for a long time, just wanted it back. It made me really angry that other people had it, and it felt like it should be ours. But to claim art is both, it takes a long time and is really expensive, because you have to pay attorney fees and provenance research fees and travel fees and all this stuff, and it all adds up. And sadly, the way most claimant families pay for it is to then sell the art, because they owe the attorneys. Most of those attorneys work on contingency basis. They take a percentage of the value of the painting. So if two paintings sold for $1,700, I mean, no matter how you slice it, the attorney's not going to get much. So they're going to charge you an hourly rate. And so that just didn't pan out. And then the question up here was, of course, about were any ever sold? And the answer is, well, yes. Yeah. So then it's hard to prove that. And so letting go of that made me realize that I could then do exactly as you're suggesting. I could build bridges with those that had it. And if I made abundantly clear, I'm not coming to collect the art, I want to see the art, can we please collaborate, that people would open their doors and let me in. And that is mostly what happens. I won't give away stories in the book, but there's a story in the book that's a pretty darn big barrier. And so not everybody has been helpful and open to me.
The next question's right up here.
The museum in Poland that has a collection as well, did they share with you with the provenance or how they got the collection, knowing that you weren't going to claim it?
So they have index cards. They're like, I don't know, 7x9, and they have information on them, but they don't have a lot. And they have information like from P. Goldberg. And I don't know who P. Goldberg is. And there's no address, and there's no phone number. And, the, you know, and if they were acquired in 1946, like, you know, I don't know how I would find the person today or their descendants. So while they do have some information, it's the idea of being able to trace it back is probably impossible, or at least incredibly difficult. And so I just have not done that.
The next question is over here.
It occurs to me that there may be many paintings out there that for whom the owner doesn't have any idea who the painter is. And I was wondering if you're getting the assistance of art historians or people who could help, say, authenticate if somebody came forward and said, I don't know if this is your great-grandfather's work or not, and whether you've got that sort of set up to help authenticate pieces that appear to be in his style.
So I'm thinking of like five answers to once to that question. There are a lot of curators and art historians that have helped me. One story that comes to mind is that one of the 52 paintings at the Jewish Historical Institute that the Institute says is my great-grandfather's does not look to me like my great-grandfather's work. There's no signature on it. I did ask two curators to look at it who are fairly familiar with my great-grandfather's work, and both agreed with me that it is not. The Jewish Historical Institute hasn't changed its mind on the labeling. I have had people contact me and say they have a painting and ask me if it's his. If it has a signature on it, that's pretty easy to say that it's not. Sometimes just the style just doesn't look anything like it to me. But of course I could be wrong. And then there's a really interesting case, which is in the book, is that there's a interest in the last few years in Poland in Polish Jewish culture and history. And there seems to be a growing phenomenon of fake pieces. And so I actually saw a piece that the signature looks really wrong to me. So it's gotten complicated. And because people now know I'm looking, then I may have created more of a hornet's nest for myself.
The next question's right over here.
Yes, you mentioned that you grew up with some of these paintings. So how many do you personally have in your own possession, your family?
My family has about 120. So Perla recovered this bundle in Praga, and she got permission. She actually had to get permission from the Polish government to take it out of Poland, and she took it to Italy. And my father and his parents, when they came to the U.S. in 1949, brought those paintings with them, and they have those today. And interestingly, my family has donated two paintings. One I mentioned is the refugees painting that was donated to Yad Vashem. There's actually another held by the Magnus Museum over in Berkeley.
We have time for one last question, and then Elizabeth will be signing at the back of the room.
I understand, I came in a little late, so I missed the beginning. Maybe you talked about it. My understanding was that your grandfather, great-grandfather grew up in Warsaw. Were most of the paintings from the Warsaw area, or did he sort of travel around the country and paint in other areas? One reason I'm asking is the following. I was born in Poland after the war. My father was a very religious Jew who came from Galicia, from a small town, not educated. He didn't believe in any entertainment at all whatsoever, except for amusement parks. And so it's sort of interesting that you have this incredible amusement park. So do you know, like, where the paintings, when majority of the paintings, where they were actually painted?
So he grew up mostly in Siedlce, which is east of Warsaw. But his adult life was spent in Warsaw. I do know that he painted in Kazimierz Dolny, which was an artist, for other people that don't know, was an artist colony on the Wisła River that a lot of Jewish artists went to paint in the summer. I mean, my educated guess is that he traveled to some places and painted, but I don't, you know, I don't have like an itinerary or a diary that says that. I mean, most of the scenes, I think, conjure up a particular time and period of Polish Jewish life and probably could be from different parts of Eastern, you know, more than Poland, Eastern Europe.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Elizabeth.